Banquets were held there too, and the players of the Commedia dell'arte performed on temporary stages. The spectacles laid on at court, on the other hand, were endowed with sumptuous choreographies, wherein halls, gardens, and entire piazzas were transformed to suit the occasion. In the Baroque period, indeed, artists worked with papier-mâché and wood, or with instable raw materials, water, fire, and firework displays. The architecture of the time coordinated the arts as a whole. Painters, sculptors, gilders, stucco workers, tapestry workers, and cabinet makers all worked under the close direction of the architect. Scenography and a theatrical style of the pictures became synonymous with pomp and circumstance. Piazza Carlina is the center of the city's second bursting of its seams. This time, the center line is Castellamonte's Via Po, which runs at an angle across the rectangular meshwork to join Piazza Castello to the city gate on the river. Its uniform facades with their unbroken arcades border what is one of the finest 17th century streets still in existence. The desire to amplify and spread abroad the image of the sovereign that inspired the way Turin was enlarged can be seen in the plates that form the Theatrum Sabaudii, a collection of engravings designed to parade the magnificence of the state of Savoy before the courts of Europe. At the end of the 17th century, Turin's endpoint in the direction of the Po was an exedra which received visitors entering its walls across the ancient bridge over the river, a sort of urban main courtyard that was also to be found on the opposite side of the city at the Susa Gate, set up during Turin's last Baroque expansion. This new spread courted the barracks designed by Filippo Iovara. Another 18th century initiative was the revamping of what is now Via Garibaldi. The structure of each block was renewed and a uniform facade was imposed. As Amedeo Grossi wrote in his Guide to Turin,
"This thoroughfare is much inhabited by merchants. The way in which it is built could well serve as a model, for one is able to walk at one's ease without being disturbed by carriages hastening to and fro."
This parabola of the development of the state of Savoy and its society had now reached its golden age, and the first king, Victor Amadeus II, was faced with the problems of reorganizing the state. In an unbroken architectural sequence, the royal palace was joined to the state bureau, the theater, and the archives, all of which enjoy an ideological continuity. A short way off stands the Royal University. It is endowed with a grandiose portico and a loggia. It was Filippo Iovara, the sovereign's trusted architect, who was to apply new measures to the fabric of the city. His hand has bequeathed the facade of Palazzo Madama. Its almost classical composure makes it a worthy flank to the ancient castle. Yet, it is above all in his great staircase in the entrance that this architect has expressed the conflict between reason and the imagination that underlies his art. This fine work was to become an incomparable example for many other pieces of architecture. In the Royal Palace itself, Iovara was responsible for a number of works. It is above all in his splendid white scissors staircase that his architectural skills found their best expression. On the hillside near Turin, rises another of these 18th century jewels, the convent church of Superga, set by Juvara as the opposite pole to another royal palace then being built at Rivoli. Superga's crypt houses the sepulchres of the kings of Savoy and many of its princes. Another superb example of Juvara's genius is the Stupinigi Hunting Lodge. This edifice can be seen as the acme of late Baroque, as well as the last example of a pleasure dome outside a city. As the power of Savoy grew, in fact, there had begun a period in which many fine country residences were constructed, such as Moncalieri Castle. Rivoli Castle. Venaria Castle. And La Mandria. A set of buildings that joined the company of the Valentino Castle, another work by Castellamonte, but of 16th century origin, which was also accessible by boat. As time passed, indeed, the river wove its way into the city layout as one of its typical features, forming, as it still does, a suggestive hinge between the hills and the habitations of this capital of the Kingdom of Savoy.